On this episode, we'll talk to an athlete who achieved his scholarship dream and how he did it. This is the Athletic Scholarship Podcast, episode number 83. Welcome to the Athletic Scholarship Podcast. I'm Jon Fugler, athletic scholarship coach and a dad of two scholarship athletes. I'm also the CEO of Recruit Me, a podcaster, author, and speaker. And our sponsor of the Athletic Scholarship Podcast is the Athletic Scholarship Playbook. It's a book that I wrote that is available on Amazon, of course. It's a complete college recruiting roadmap for high school athletes and parents. Check it out. And this podcast is 15 minutes that will change your scholarship future. I dig in. I give you takeaways you can use immediately. And you can find every episode on my website at recruitme.com, but it's easier on an app, the Apple Podcast app, Stitcher, TuneIn Radio, iHeart, and others. Well, on this episode, I want to let you know, too, you can get the free chapter from my book, The Athletic Scholarship Playbook. If you haven't yet, go get it. It's not going to be up much longer. I'm going to switch that out. I was going to do it by now, but because we're kind of heading down a road, I want to head down now. And in this group of episodes, this series, I'm going to leave it up there for you at recruitme.com. I got a guest on this show, and he's one with experience from a lot of different angles. My guest is Nate Sallee, and Nate is a former athlete, baseball player, college. His wife is a former athlete. She's a D1 scholarship athlete and coach, former coach. And in this family, they've got a lot of experience from a number of different angles. So, Nate, thanks for joining me on this episode.
Hey, John, great to be here. It's an honor.
Well, I want to dig into some things with you, and here we are. By the way, you're up really late. We're recording this 10 o'clock Eastern time on Monday night.
I love it.
You've had a full day. It's 8 o'clock here, Mountain Time, but we are going to get this released tomorrow on Tuesday because that's my promise to everybody. So I got to live up to my promises, right?
That's awesome. Well, I got my Arnold Palmer drinking here. Get some sugar. I'm good to go.
Okay. Is that your drink of choice as an athlete, huh?
It's my go-to, yeah.
Okay. Fantastic. And I'm talking to you. You're in Kentucky right now, right?
I am. I'm in Florence, Kentucky, just south. I don't claim Cincinnati, but gosh, we are close. We're about 10 minutes south of Cincinnati.
Oh, okay. Okay. That gives me some perspective. And I know my wife is down watching the Olympics right now. I don't know if your wife is now, but we're missing it. You and I are missing it.
We are. I heard curling is just the thing right now. Everybody's talking about curling. I saw somebody on Facebook. It was a mom doing a Swiffer right in front of one of those Zumba vacuums, and it was like their version of curling in their kitchen. I was cracking up.
That's great. Hey, I gotta ask you, as an athlete, gonna set some perspective here, but just jump right in and tell us your story as a college athlete.
Okay. Yeah, my journey as a college athlete, it really began as a dream. My freshman year, I had my older stepbrother. He played at Murray State. He was a baseball player and played a couple years of pro ball. And he set just a great role model of just a blue-collar work ethic. He ended up being a personal trainer. And I put a lot of time getting strong and really training and getting the physical part down to give myself a fighting chance, because I knew a lot of kids were trying to get this scholarship. And I purposed to be the best player, to be the leader, to be the captain on my high school team. And I wasn't, we weren't state champions or anything like that. But I really worked hard, and we took a lot of initiative. And I'll never forget, my stepdad came down, and I had a basement bedroom, and he had just got done. We had sent some emails out to some coaches, and he finally, it was about my junior year. And he was just like, "Hey, you're putting in all this work and you're doing so great. But we have to do something. Like, we have to start taking this into our own hands. Nobody else is losing sleep or super worried about your future. They all are in your corner and support you and giving you pats on the back. But at the end of the day, no one else is taking action for us. We have to go and do something and go after this." And that really stuck with me. And that really paved the way for me to get the opportunity that I did.
So this was like a 4-year deal that you said you started freshman year with sights on a scholarship.
I did. I was driving in my stepbrother's 4Runner. We were driving to go work out. And he said, Nate, if you had a dream for a minute and you knew you couldn't fail, where would you want to go? And at that point, I was thinking, gosh, man, University of Miami down in Florida would be amazing. They have beaches. They have baseball. I'm sure there's a ton of girls down there.
They don't have winter.
Yeah, there's no winter. Like, that would be beautiful. You know, and at that point, you know, Miami was, yeah, it just seemed like the perfect campus. But that was my dream for a moment. It was healthy to just sit back and say, what do I want? Where do I want to be in 5-10 years, and try to reverse engineer that a little bit. And while I didn't make it to Miami, I still really, I think about that often, about how you really take a second to dream for a moment and how powerful that can be. And then you start thinking, okay, if that's where I want to be, then that's going to affect what I do today.
How'd you keep that dream alive? How'd you keep the dream alive for 4 years?
Well, another conversation I had is I was on a treadmill and my stepbrother was right next to me, and he said, "Hey, I know that you're going to be the captain. You're going to start." I was a catcher. He's like, "You're going to bat third or fourth in the lineup. You're going to be one of their main hitters. So we know right now you're one of the best players on your team. But what about Josh Franklin? What about Zach Upton? What about Josh Rogers?" And he was naming catchers of other high quality high school teams in the area, and he was planting in me of like, "Oh man, like, just because I'm the starter on one team doesn't mean I get a free ride." And it really just drove me to just be the best version of me. I wanted to untap and unlock the potential that I had.
Well, Nate is talking about something here that, listeners, you hear this, parent, as you hear this, athlete, as you hear this, you can't go it alone. He had somebody come alongside him and push him, or else he would have lost that vision, that dream, that enthusiasm. And that's a big part of going the distance, is having somebody come alongside you.
Absolutely. That's doing this together, I think, might be one of the biggest takeaways on how to do it. On, like, we say on your own, but we really mean on your own as a family, or as, you know, parent or guardian or somebody really close to you. Because if you are trying to go after something really big alone, there's just too many opportunities to second guess yourself, to start believing things that aren't true, to start listening to that little voice inside your head that's trying to bring you down. You need somebody else in your corner that's going to speak life into you to keep going.
So how did that journey end for you through high school and where you landed?
Well, through a lot of really just taking initiative and sending out emails, and that we hand selected some showcases and some camps. Some were better than others, and reaching out when we were on campus visits, we would always try to reach out to the baseball coach of the schools we thought would be a good fit. And eventually I was able to position myself where I was attractive enough athletically. Then I also had some academic merit that really got me some academic scholarship, which in the baseball world, you don't get hardly any full rides. Makes you more attracted to a coach if he doesn't have to spend as much money on you.
Sure.
So really part of what opened the door to play Division I is the fact that I got a full tuition academic scholarship. And when we met the head coach there, we had a really good conversation. And a lot of it was actually, I mean, he knew that I was a pretty solid high school player, but he saw, really what he told me was just my character, my makeup, and my resume, what I was about. He could tell that I was just going to be a good asset to their team.
So it's not just the athletic ability. You mentioned character. And, of course, with an academic scholarship, the academics, and that's huge, because coaches want players are going to stay in school. They want a good fit, and knowing you're coming in with that academic edge is a big deal. So that's kind of the second takeaway on this conversation, is the academics, and I guess even more than that, the full package of what an athlete brings to a college or university.
Absolutely. If you think about it, I was going to raise his team GPA, which is going to help his cause. I wasn't going to be a headache on whether or not I was going to be eligible. And if, in theory, you know, you have enough kids that have, you know, solid academic standing, they kind of raise the bar, they raise the level of expectation for the team as a whole. So I think there's a lot of things that go into play when you do that.
Well, I'm going to pull
really
the curtain,
open the door.
I want to pull the curtain back a little bit for our listener, because I haven't told you this, athlete, I haven't told you this, parent, but Nate and his wife have founded Visionary Athlete, and they actually train athletes in the college recruiting process. And Nate, you learned a lot in your process, and even in college and then beyond that. I want you to jump forward a little bit and tell us how you ended up now training and teaching other families in this process.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, it's interesting. As soon as my wife and I, we got married, we actually met in college. She was a volleyball player. I was a baseball player. And we ended up getting married in Northern Kentucky area. She was a graduate assistant at Morehead State. So she was an All-American setter, incredible athlete, a great volleyball player there at Morehead. She stayed and got her master's and was a graduate assistant and helped in a lot of areas, one of them being recruiting. But then once we moved up here, she got the bug again and started coaching high school volleyball. And in her first year as a head varsity coach, she had two seniors that she only had 1 year with. And they were great girls, played at a pretty high level. They played club. They were investing in, you know, in that whole side of things as well. And they wanted to play in college. But nobody had offered them at that point. And we kind of just poked into that a little bit and said, well, you know, kind of why is that? And really what we got is they weren't taking any action. They hadn't shot one skills video or recruiting video. They hadn't sent one email out to a coach. They were just playing the fall school season.
And they were hoping they would be found, right?
And just hoping and hoping and hoping that they were going to be discovered. And if you're in the top 3%, that's probably going to be a good plan for you. Like, you're going to get found if you're in the top 3% of the whole country. But there is so much more out there. And the difference is who's going to overcome their fear of failure and fear of rejection, which I believe you probably touched on a little bit in the last episode, and take action and put themselves out there and learn. So within weeks, we said, do you really want to play? Because if you do, we'll help you. We don't want to force you or push behind something you don't want to do. But if you really want to, we'll help you. And within about 6 weeks, we had coached them personally. We shot a skills video and sent it out to some coaches and trained them on how to go about communicating with coaches and some things to be thinking about. And within about 6 weeks, both of them had offers.
Wow. Wow.
And we just sat back and we're like, oh my goodness, like there's a huge need here. We were doing it kind of winging it just from our own experience and doing it on the fly in a huge time crunch. I mean, it was within about 6 months they needed to find an opportunity. We're like, man, how do we help more families serve this need? Because if you think about it, when people graduate and they go on, that family, as soon as the youngest goes through the college recruiting process and they're done, it's not like there's a huge army of families going back to train the next generation or the next 5-10 years worth of other families. Everybody's kind of has one shot at this. And we just really wanted to fill that gap and to serve families and give them the tools and really just the encouragement and the permission to go for it and swing the bat.
Oh, that's cool. I love the way you say that. Give them permission to go for it. And you and I have talked back and forth over the past few weeks leading up to this interview, and you and I kind of are kindred spirits in that we both really want to empower the families, want to teach and train the families, and not get in there as their personal coach, but give them what they need to succeed on their own. Did I state that right?
Absolutely. You and I both, we would much rather teach you how to fish than to promise you the moon and try to act like we're going to do everything for you, because we don't feel like that's the best route anyway. Coaches have said they don't want to hear from a recruiting service or a third party. They want to hear from the athlete and maybe your high school coach.
And
if that's the case, then we need to give you the tools to do that. That's the best way we could serve you. Yeah.
Well, and we're running out of time here in this episode. I want to bring you back next week, because the question I was hoping to get to this week, but I'm going to just open it up for next week, is what did you do right that you feel you did right in the recruiting process? And then the second question is, what do you wish you would have done now that you look back on it many, many years later? So I'm going to ask you those questions next week. I want to invite you back on the Athletic Scholarship Podcast. And let our listeners get to know you, get to know your heart, and get to know some tips, some advice from one who's experienced at this. But first of all, before we go, I do want to ask you this. What's the one piece of advice that you can offer families
I would say to go with this process on purpose together. So make sure you have a purpose behind it and you're doing it intentionally where you want to go and do it together. If you have both of those things, I think you can go a long way.
Great. On purpose and together. And so that purpose, you're talking about having a goal, or maybe unpack that a little bit more for us, on purpose.
Well, having a vision for where you want to be. So just like I was already trying to kind of get clarity on where I wanted to be in 5 or 10 years, you need to have a purpose. Your sport, this scholarship, needs to be a tool for a much greater thing later on in life. If 4 more years of playing your sport is the end all, then we need to pull back and look at the bigger picture and think, how could this serve a bigger vision for my life? So that's where the purpose spot comes in.
Okay, great. Thank you, Nate. And we're going to talk to you again next week. You can go to Nate's website to find out more about him and Caitlin and their story and what they have to offer at visionaryathlete.com, visionaryathlete.com. As I want to do, I want to equip and empower you to get an athletic scholarship. And so do Nate and Caitlin. They want to do the same thing. So we decide, let's get together, let's talk about this and see what we can put our heads together and come up with some counsel for families and really give you that encouragement, not only that, but also the power and the tools to move forward and achieve your scholarship dream. So, Nate, come back next week, and we'll do this again.
I appreciate it, John. Had a lot of fun. Thank you.
Okay, take care. As we leave this episode, just want to remind you that I've got that free chapter from my book, The Athletic Scholarship Playbook. You can go get that at recruitme.com, recruit-me.com. Until next time, have a great week, and root for your favorite Olympians.